Good morning. We are with FTC Commissioner Phillips to discuss hot topics in healthcare enforcement, FTC healthcare enforcement. In 2018, the president appointed Noah Phillips to be a commissioner at the FTC. In the spring of 2018, the Senate unanimously confirmed him. Before coming to the FTC, Commissioner Phillips served as chief counsel to U.S. Senator on the Senate Judiciary Committee. The views expressed by Commissioner Phillips are his own. He's not speaking for the full commission or any other commissioners. We also have Jim Fishkin. Jim is with Dechert in Washington, D.C. Jim worked for over 15 years in merger enforcement at the Federal Trade Commission. I am Mike Cowie. I'm also with Dechert in D.C. I formerly served as FTC Senior Litigation Counsel and as an assistant director responsible for merger enforcement. So again, we're focusing on the healthcare sector, including life sciences. Commissioner Phillips, before we get into any specific cases or policies, is there any overarching theme that you'd want the listeners to take away from this discussion?
Sure. Well, let me just begin by thanking Dechert and thanking you, Mike, and you, Jim, for having me today. I wish we had been able to do this in person, which I believe was the original plan. But in lieu of that, I'll sort of take the internet. I think the most important thing for folks to focus on is that the FTC has been pretty aggressive in the healthcare space in the creativity I think we've been bringing to cases, including a number of Section 2 monopolization cases, in the remedies that we've been demanding in merger consents. And I would expect that trend to continue. There is a lot of talk, as we all know, including this week, about a broad national focus on antitrust issues in the tech space. And the tech space is a space that warrants antitrust interest. But healthcare has long been a focus for the FTC, and I think it will remain so for the foreseeable future.
Commissioner Phillips?
Yep.
This past summer, the FTC and DOJ issued vertical merger guidelines. In the healthcare sector, we've seen companies evolving with different delivery models and different platforms. Some of these involve vertical integration, such as health insurers combining with providers. How do you see the role of antitrust enforcement for these types of vertical transactions?
So, I mean, I think it's going to be an area of continued scrutiny, right? There's a lot of different vertical arrangements that might raise antitrust concerns. You know, insurer, provider combinations have raised antitrust concerns. We brought a case against and did a consent with United DaVita, which was a merger in this space, and the allegations involving the Nevada market included vertical allegations. And there, as we all know, is a lot of M&A activity in that space. By the same token, in pharmaceuticals, you know, there are cases that may involve critical inputs to manufacturing or other processes that could raise concerns. I don't, and you know, the vertical merger guideline even talks about some hypotheticals in the healthcare space. Look, I think we see a lot of activity. Much of that activity is innocuous or pro-competitive. But some of it may be anti-competitive. And again, I think it's going to be an area of continued focus.
Yeah, the vertical merger guidelines mentioned as an illustration, a drug manufacturer combining with a supplier of active ingredients. Is that the type of transaction or fact pattern that would be under scrutiny?
It very well may. And certainly manufacturers of APIs have, and the access of buyers for those products in the market have come up as areas of concern in cases at which we've looked. It's not the only area, but it's certainly one of them.
I think you mentioned, Commissioner Phillips, that most vertical transactions are competitively benign. I don't want to put words in your mouth. The Justice Department on CVS Aetna, a transaction which Dechert was involved with, issued a public statement saying the vertical merger has the potential to achieve efficiencies. So separate from that transaction, what role does efficiencies play in the FTC's evaluation of vertical mergers?
So we take a careful look at the role of efficiencies in all mergers, including vertical mergers. To some extent, vertical mergers distinguish themselves because just as you can have, depending on the structure of a market and other facts, concerns about raising rivals' costs and foreclosure from the natural financial incentives of the merging parties, by the same token, you can have EDM, the elimination of double marginalization, as an incentive that the parties have to reduce costs for consumers or folks downline. And we take a careful look at those. The merger guidelines instruct a fair amount of skepticism with respect to efficiencies. You know, they have to be well established and they have to be merger specific and so forth. But it's certainly something that the guidelines recognize and that I think where appropriate, we ought to take into account. I do think you've seen a lot of skepticism from some folks, including on the commission, about efficiencies generally. And so that's also an area to continue to watch going forward.
Well, it's great to hear your willingness to account for efficiencies. I know that's been an area where, you know, on the defense side, sometimes we feel like we see a high degree of skepticism and the courts have been somewhat unfriendly on efficiencies. You mentioned United Health DaVita. So this was a combination of a health insurer and a physician group in several states. The FTC brought an enforcement action, obtaining relief in Nevada. And you, you, Commissioner Phillips, issued a concurring statement indicating you were not supporting relief in an additional state, Colorado. And I think you mentioned there was analysis of a vertical theory raising rivals' cost. How did you balance the, you know, the efficiencies or pro-competitive benefits versus the vertical concern of raising rivals' costs in that, you know, public matter?
So I think, like in any case, we're going to look at what the party's representations show. We're going to talk to folks in the market, you know this better than I do, about how they think the deal will operate. We'll take documents, testimony if it's necessary. We'll do financial modeling to sort of see how the incentives play out. In that case, Commissioner Wilson and I didn't think we had a strong case that there would be harm in Colorado. Our fellow commissioners disagreed with that. I think the Attorney General of Colorado also disagreed. I continue to believe the facts supported the action in Nevada, but not the one in Colorado. But it's always a case-by-case determination.
In that case, Commissioner Phillips, the relief that you and others on the commission supported was structural relief. It was divestiture of assets associated with the business. In some FTC vertical merger challenges, there have been behavioral remedies. And you could think of these as typically firewalls and controls on information exchange. Could you explain, you know, your thinking on structural versus behavioral remedies in the vertical context?
So, and I think this is pretty consistent across the board. My preference tends to be for structural remedies, you know, especially where we have a context where the merger hasn't occurred, eggs are not yet scrambled. A structural remedy done properly allows competition to continue in the market without a lot of oversight from us. Whereas a behavioral remedy, we have to watch it. I don't think, and that's something you hear from enforcers across the board, right, at the Department of Justice, at FTC. It's something we write publicly, we say publicly. I don't think that behavioral remedies should be off the table. There may be times where structural relief doesn't quite work, but there are other aspects that should permit the merger to continue. So I wouldn't take behavioral remedies off the table entirely, but certainly there is a preference for structural relief when we're looking at a merger prophylactically.
Okay. Well, that's an important message, that behavioral remedies may still be on the radar. That's something you...
At least for me.
You could... Yeah, okay. Just to clarify, are you able, I appreciate this is a difficult sentence outside the context of a particular matter, but are you able to identify any principles where you think behavioral would be acceptable versus the default of structural?
Well, I think structural remains the default. There may be a set of circumstances where it's not workable to do a structural remedy, let's say, or the concern about the harm is so narrow and our confidence in the workability and the administrability of the behavioral remedy is so great that that is preferable. It may depend on how the market looks and the availability of other buyers. I can think of a lot of different facts that might lean in that direction, but I do think the default, the preference is certainly and will remain certainly to be structural remedies.
Got it. Okay. Message received. Let's shift to early stage competition in life sciences. Bristol-Myers Celgene was a major matter. The FTC required BMS to divest a blockbuster psoriasis drug for over $13 billion. It's the largest FTC divestiture ever as measured by purchase price. I'm just looking at the Public Materials Commissioner Phillips, and what the FTC said is that the competitive psoriasis drug or project was the most advanced. The FTC said it would likely be the next entrant into the market. There's not a lot of other public information on that pipeline product. For example, was it phase three? Was it phase two? Is it likely to be commercialized within 1 year, 2 year, 3 years? And we appreciate there's a lot of there are confidentiality restrictions on that. But I was wondering if you could speak to any guidepost on how we should think about pipeline products in terms of, FTC merger analysis or competitive analysis.
Sure. So I think it probably is important to begin with some table setting, and that is that one movement, I think, in practice over time has been in favor of leaving the risk with the merging parties as opposed to consumers. And so if you've got an on-market drug competing with a drug that is still in development, the divestiture may have to be of the on-market drug that continues to get sold and the risk is carried by the parties. That's something that then Bureau Director Bruce Hoffman announced, I think in 2018 in a speech, and that's sort of in the general policy. So with respect to where the drug is in development, at a broad level, I want to say it always depends on the facts of the case, but it would seem to me a corollary with that our concern about the likelihood of competition for a drug in phase one would be less because that drug's entry into market as a competitor would be more speculative than one in phase three. It was a public matter, by the way, that the the sort of nascent drug, if you will, in that case, was in phase three trials. I think the practice has generally been we'd look with, as a general matter, we'd look at a drug in phase three, you know, and think it has a greater likelihood. Phase two, less so, but we're still sometimes looking, depending on the facts and circumstances and what the competition looks like and what are the things we're hearing. And of course, phase one is the least likely as a general matter, and so might pose the least issue. I should say that's really a conversation to me most about branded pharmaceuticals. I think if you're in the context of, you know, biologics, I don't know that we know quite as much. We just haven't done as many of those cases. So I don't know that what I'm saying is mappable necessarily onto that market. And, you know, if we're looking at a generic, one thing we'll be looking at is, you know, have they filed their ANDA, this kind of thing. There's a whole process, as you know, set up generic drugs to market, and it doesn't require the same set of approval processes that a new branded drug does.
Thank you. That's very helpful guidance. So I may try to paraphrase, and you could push back. And again, I appreciate you're not speaking for the commission, but in the branded drug case, you know, what we're hearing, and I think this is consistent with past FTC experience, is if you're in phase three, that's very likely to be treated as a competitor. If you're in phase one, it's too crystal ball. You don't know whether you're going to be commercialized, so that's unlikely. It sounds like there's a point of view, Commissioner Phillips, that phase three may be a gray area. Maybe it depends on the therapeutic category, or, you know, where the particular project is in, you know, in its own timeline. Is that a fair summary of your views?
My only quibble, Mike, is just assigning any kind of probability. I think you used the term for phase three, very likely. The way I would put it is that if a drug is in phase three as a general matter, it would be more likely to be a competitor. Phase two, less than phase three, more than phase one, and phase one, less likely than the other phases. But again, and I do want to underscore this point, we're going to be asking a lot more questions than simply where is the drug in terms of its development path in front of the FDA. We're going to be asking questions about how the market looks, about the particulars of that development, things like that.
Thank you. That's very helpful guidance. Commissioner Phillips, you started by referring to all the attention in high tech. And I took you to be saying that healthcare very much remains a focus area of the FTC. No question, high tech is getting a lot of attention. When I have been speaking to life science companies about that, I've raised concerns about the spillover effect. So you see, you know, different public interest groups criticize the FTC or DOJ. They say, you know, you, the FTC, should have blocked Google, YouTube. You know, that was about 15 years ago, where you, the FTC, DOJ, should have blocked Facebook, Instagram. That was about almost 10 years ago. And I personally have superficial knowledge of those deals, especially at that time. But there's a point of view that, you know, YouTube in 2006, you might think of them analytically like almost like a phase one product or a phase two product, or same for Instagram and other acquisition targets. They're not the commercialized products they are today. So the concern is that precedent in high tech on nascent competition could shift the analysis in life sciences, because you're reaching, you might be reaching back earlier and earlier. So I wonder if you could just speak to that. I appreciate this is more of a speech than a question, but any reaction would be great.
No, I appreciate the speech. Let me sort of start with the following and then come back to the fundamentals, I think, of what you are asking. Some of the empirical research underlying concerns in tech actually comes from healthcare, right? The phrase killer acquisitions that has become like part of the broad rhetoric that you see in op-ed pages and by members of Congress, that's from a paper about pharmaceutical drugs, right? That's the, we've all kind of read it, but that's Cunningham, Etterer, and Ma looking at sub-HSR, what's happening to the apparent path of development for drugs. And you can quibble with that, but that's a great example of like research in the healthcare space bleeding over into the discussion of tech. I think broadly speaking, everyone across the board is looking with more care at nascent competition issues more broadly. You know, you've seen cases brought by us, by DOJ, sometimes they've succeeded, sometimes they haven't. And sorry, I said nascent competition. I also mean potential competition cases, because there are a bunch of different concepts that sort of get lumped together. So I do think that's going to be an area of renewed focus. I would note, right, the House report that came out a couple weeks ago, this is 400 and some odd pages, and it follows a year plus of investigation, and they collected millions of documents and took a lot of testimony and so forth, is a kind of case study of four companies, all in the tech space, and then arrives at conclusions for pretty dramatic legislative reform across the board. So I don't think there's any question in my mind, and I think this is something for folks to keep in mind, that proposals that are being nominally directed at big tech are not just about big tech. They won't just affect big tech, and we can argue about the particulars of the proposals, but the vision is much grander. I was listening to one of the public interest group folks, or he's a journalist or something, talking on a podcast a few weeks ago, and the first line he gave about the House report is, it's important to understand this isn't just about big tech. That's absolutely right. So I do think, you know, you're talking about spillover effect in terms of precedent in court cases. And of course, that can always happen with Section 7 and Section 2 cases. But the legislative attempts, the national dialogue, very focused on a particular, really small set of companies, but absolutely applicable more broadly.
So we all need to watch these big tech cases, no matter the industry. Yeah. Jim, you want to pick up on state AGs?
Sure. Commissioner Phillips, as Mike said, we're going to switch to a new topic. The FTC, as you know, has a long history of working with state attorneys general on hospital mergers and acquisitions of physician practices. That includes, for example, the FTC and the North Dakota Attorney General's office jointly challenging and ultimately blocking Sanford Health's acquisition of Mid Dakota Clinic. Commissioner Chopra, however, noted in his dissent to the AbbVie allergen consent that the FTC should increase coordination and cooperation with the state attorneys general in investigations of large pharmaceutical mergers. To what extent does the FTC work with state attorneys general on large pharmaceutical merger investigations, including proposed remedies? And is the FTC working on any procedures, for example, to increase the level of coordination and cooperation between the states and the FTC?
So I'm not aware of any particular like MOUs, procedural fixes on which we're working. As a general matter, as you know, we work a lot with state AGs in cases of particular local concern like hospitals and other cases of national concern, like let's say pharmaceuticals. I mentioned earlier the United DeVita case. That was obviously a case where there was some disagreement between the commission and a state AG. But as a general matter, I think there's a lot of work that is done jointly. And as a general matter, I think that's good. The one thing I'd add is, as in any market, there's substitution and there's complementarity. And I think that there's a lot of work to be done in the antitrust space, and antitrust enforcers will serve the public better when we're trying to think of ways to complement each other's efforts, right? There is a lot of work to do, and focusing on, hey, I can't do this case with the resources I have, maybe you can take it, is a much better conversation than some of what goes on, not at all limited to the healthcare space, of using the same case as an opportunity to sort of point fingers at the other guy and maybe even bring in cases in opposition. Those cases often don't work well. They may serve the purpose of generating headlines and preening, but I don't know that they're necessarily good. What I want to see is the federal agencies and the state enforcers figuring out a comprehensive strategy to address the problems that everybody sees.
Of that you're referring to?
Sorry, Jim, I missed the beginning of your question.
You were just referring to perhaps some, coordination with the states in some respects. What examples are you alluding to?
Oh, look, we're in court right now in Philadelphia to block a hospital merger, and we're there with the state AG, and Mike alluded to this earlier, but it's in our experience, it's really helpful to have local authorities on the ground help deal with these issues. My real goal, my sort of vision for this is, we are a small agency, and we have a lot of work to do. And my dream is that, if we can't handle something, that there's somebody else who can, because I think we've sometimes spot more problems in the market than we're able to address. And maybe a case doesn't require federal attention, but it ought to require state attention. That to me is a better world of kind of combined antitrust enforcement.
Commissioner Phillips, we have seen state AGs become more active and independent over the last few years, including the state's challenge to the T-Mobile Sprint merger, despite the parties having entered into a settlement agreement with DOJ. What role do you see the state AGs in any way, and this is following up what you had mentioned earlier, what role do you see them playing vis-a-vis the FTC in the healthcare area?
Again, fundamentally, what I would like to see is complementarity between the federal agencies and the state AGs. And sometimes that means working together on particular cases, and sometimes that may be taking on different challenges. That to me is the best arrangement between the federal and state authorities. There's often a lot of communication. That communication is good. It can help us get new inputs, look at things in new ways that may be helpful to the work that we're doing. Look, I'm really proud to go into court with the Attorney General of the State of New York in the Viera case, which is a really important case that we brought, which is a monopolization case. Those kinds of efforts are ongoing today. I think they're going to continue. People don't always agree, but I do think there is more work to be done. And the best way to tackle that work is sort of as complements rather than as competitors.
That's a good segue into a different topic, and that is the FTC has been quite active on the Section 2 front, bringing several monopolization cases in the healthcare industry since your appointment as a commissioner. Are there common themes among these cases, and what can we take away from these?
The cases that we've brought, the Section 2 cases that we've brought in the healthcare space are not at all monolithic, right? One of them is a merger case. There are a couple cases involving product topping. There and deception involved in switching from one drug to another. There are cases involving distribution. SureScripts is really a network effects contracting case. So I don't know that there's a common theme beyond to say that we see problems from time to time in healthcare markets. They're not operating as efficiently as they can. They're not operating as competitively as they can. Section 2 is an important tool that we're willing to use, and I think we're willing to think creatively about its application. That, to me, is the common theme between these cases. I mean, if you look at Viera, or you look at Illumina, or you look at SureScripts, the fact patterns are different, the markets are different, but what they all reflect is, I think, a lot of interest in the agency and how healthcare markets are functioning, and a concern, right, that monopolists are going to take measures that step outside the law to continue their monopoly in an illegal way.
Now, based on these recent experiences. Based on these.
Excuse me, Jim, I just wanted.
Go ahead, Mike.
Commissioner Phillips, on Section 2, what is your view on the use of disgorgement? And again, we appreciate there's litigation out there that bears on this, but if you're comfortable, it would be, I think, useful for the business community and the bar to hear your views on disgorgement, particularly in the Section 2 context.
So, you know, I think I kind of adhere to the traditional standard. You know, the agency had a policy. The policy has been pulled down, but we kind of proceeded with it. Disgorgement remains a tool that's available. I don't think it's good as a policy matter that tool is not on the table at all. I do think we have to think about, in a context of legal novelty, what role monetary remedies have. Right now, to be honest, though, the big discussion is what the Supreme Court is going to do with Section 13B. Right? And if the Supreme Court goes the way of the Third Circuit, if it goes the way of the Seventh Circuit, can we get a remedy from Congress? And then how does that remedy look? To me, that's the big question.
Jim, I interrupted
following
you, but
up
go
on,
ahead.
Yeah, that's where we... It's good to have some additional questions here. But do you, going forward, should we be expecting, you know, in the bar to see more potential Section 2 cases in the healthcare industry?
Look, I think we've been pretty active on Section 2. I'm not going to talk about particular scenarios. But I do think it's a tool in our toolbox, and we're continuing to scrutinize markets. I think it's safe to say that, you know, sort of today's Federal Trade Commission is a pretty active one. I find almost ridiculous criticisms that we're not. Whether the slope is going to continue where we are today, or whether we're going to increase our level of enforcement or utilization of Section 2, I think, depends on factors that we may know soon, but are somewhat outside of my pay grade. But I don't see necessarily a decline. Now, not every case is appropriate for Section 2 treatment, right? And while it is true that we've brought a fair amount of these cases in my tenure, it's not as if a Section 2 case comes up every day. But I don't think it's a tool that we've been neglecting, and I don't think it's a tool that we're going to continue to neglect. I think it's quite the opposite.
Commissioner Phillips, the FTC has traditionally evaluated pharmaceutical mergers on a product overlap basis. And some critics of this approach argue that it ignores potential issues such as innovation effects or portfolio effects, and leads to increased overall concentration in the pharmaceutical industry. What is your reaction to these calls to change how the FTC evaluates pharmaceutical mergers?
there are two important things that I would say. The first is, while product overlap has always been a particular concern and will remain so, we have been looking at other things as well. We've been looking at portfolio effects. We've been looking at innovation effects. To me, the question is, do we have evidence that suggests that those effects exist and will be negative? Right? And if we do, what is the appropriate remedy? And how are we going to build a case on that if we need to do so? The debate seems to be about what are the set of facts necessary to establish those facts for purposes of liability. And what I don't agree with, what I really reject, is the notion that every merger is going to raise the whole panoply of potential effects that any merger in the pharmaceutical space raises. And that all those mergers should be stopped whether we have the facts or not. I don't think that's what the law commands. I don't think that's particularly good policy. But should we look at broader effects than just single product overlap? I do think that's right. And I think that's what we've been doing.
Hey, Jim, just to augment what Commissioner Phillips just said for the listeners, in Teva activists, the FTC issued public statements indicating it analyzed portfolio effects in generic drugs, and it also suggested it also looked at beyond product by product to see if there's certain categories of drugs like complex injectables that should be viewed as a category. I think, Commissioner Phillips, that preceded you joining the FTC in 2018 by a bit, if I recall. But there is, again, just for the viewers, listeners, there is a public FTC analysis spelling out that it has investigated at least generic drug deals on a portfolio effects basis.
Thanks, Mike.
Commissioner Phillips, in 2019, the FTC announced a settlement in the Bristol-Myers Squibb Celgene pharmaceutical merger. You issued a rather forceful concurring statement supporting the settlement, in which you addressed a number of criticisms, one of which was that the FTC's investigations of pharmaceutical mergers fail to capture all of the harms to competition posed by such mergers. Can you explain what compelled you to write your statement?
So what compelled me to write my statement were the dissents, which said precisely what you said, but what they lacked were facts and legal theory. There were general gripes about what negative effects pharmaceutical mergers in general could have, but very, very light on what threat that particular merger posed and into what legal framework that might fall. And that's what I wrote in my statement. I said that the approach was rather like, you know, in criminal law saying, well, I think there are too many muggings in society, and so you are guilty. And I said, it's not a good thing that, you know, it wouldn't be a good thing if criminal law operated that way. And by the same token, I don't think merger review should operate that way. I speculated that what we might be experiencing was just a general dislike for pharmaceutical mergers. And that's all well and good if you take that policy view, but it's not an antitrust case. It's a general view. That's not a basis to prevent parties from merging legally. And I think I said in my statement, I don't think it's the right policy that, you know, the government shouldn't have to prove its case.
Commissioner Phillips, the same issue regarding whether a settlement was sufficient came up again this year when the FTC announced it obtained divestitures of three pharmaceutical products in the AbbVie allergen deal. As with the Bristol-Myers Squibb Celgene matter, there was vigorous debate between the Republican and the Democratic commissioners from both sides, authoring statements in support of their decisions. One theme that Commissioner Chopra focused on in his dissent was the idea of incentives, arguing that the divestiture buyers in AbbVie Allergan would not be incentivized to continue developing a drug post-divestiture. Is it fair to say that the issues that surfaced in Bristol-Myers Squibb came to a head in the AbbVie Allergan matter? And do you have any additional comments to provide?
I think there are some analogs between the two. In a sense, the AbbVie Allergan dissents were more satisfying to me in that at least they identified issues, right, as opposed to general concerns about pharmaceutical mergers. With respect to incentives, I mean, the line I recall had to do with, because the divesting companies would be required to continue to pay for the development, I think it was brazikumab and its divestiture to AstraZeneca. Commissioner Chopra was concerned that that only created an option and the company would walk away from it. To me, that's counterintuitive. I mean, I think it's a kind of sunk cost fallacy, but it's also counterintuitive because had the acquiring company, right, the third party that buys the divested product, had to invest, I suspect the quibble would have been, this will be expensive and they won't have an incentive to develop it. It didn't seem quite right to argue that they would have less of an incentive because they would make more money. That just didn't follow to me as a logical matter. I do think that we are always going to look at the capability of the purchasing party, the incentives that they have, right? We want remedies to work. Everybody wants, I think everybody wants remedies to work, unless I guess you're competing with them. But certainly from the enforcer perspective, that's right. What I think we have to think about, though, is what do the incentives actually dictate, right? What is the kind of proof that we have? Is the quibble with the remedy that we're achieving well-founded or not?
Commissioner Chopra, in his dissent to the AbbVie Allergan consent agreement, expressed concerns about divesting two of the pharmaceutical products to Nestle, a large global firm, perhaps better known for its food and beverage products. How did you get comfortable that Nestle would be able to replace the competition lost as part of that large merger?
So we applied to Nestle the same traditional tools of analysis that we use for lots of divestiture buyers. It's true, Nestle is not principally a pharmaceutical company. It's also true that Nestle has a very large and growing portfolio of nutrition products that they spend the same time, or a lot of the same time that pharmaceutical companies do, with doctors and clinics and this kind of thing, and that they're growing that portfolio. That growth isn't limited to the divestitures in this case, and that's worthy of note. The other thing I think is worth flagging is I don't know that entry is such a bad thing in competition, right? Nestle is a very large company. It's got a lot of financial resources. And as a general matter, entry is something that we encourage. We would be glad if Nestle was moving into the pharmaceutical space. And whether that's organically through development or by M&A, I think it's a good thing. So there's a bit of a counterintuitive quality to this critique.
I'd like to slightly move on to a different topic regarding private equity and roll-ups in the healthcare industry. Roll-ups, as you know, are transactions that are a series of small transactions in which a firm acquires multiple companies in the same industry and combines them together. many of these transactions are not HSR reportable based on, you know, their small dollar size. Commissioner Chopra has expressed concerns about roll-up transactions in the healthcare sector, arguing that they may result in higher costs and reduction in quality of care. He most recently raised these concerns in July in a statement with the FTC and DOJ's annual report to Congress. What is your view on roll-up transactions in the healthcare sector? And do you share any of those concerns?
My concern is with transactions that create anti-competitive effects. Whether they are in the healthcare sector or outside, whether private equity is involved with them or not, whether they are part of a roll-up strategy or not. To the extent there are transactions that are sub-HSR and present competitive problems, our doors are open and we want to know about those. We'll read about them in the press and maybe we'll express some interest. I suspect that the overwhelming bulk of roll-up transactions don't meet that test. There are economies of scale. That's part of the basis for roll-ups. I suspect monopolization is not the basis for most of those business strategies. So to me, it's not a question of whether it's private equity. It's not a question of whether it's in the healthcare space. The question is the effects. Now, one of the things that makes the healthcare space very interesting, right, is whether it's a doctor group or what have you, especially in local markets or a hospital group or so forth, even transactions that are smaller in terms of their, you know, asset value, right, in terms of the valuation, can raise competitive concerns. I definitely think we ought to be looking at those, and some of those may be roll-ups. But it isn't the roll-up quality of the thing, and it's certainly not the private equity ownership of the thing that might condemn a transaction.
Commissioner Chopra has also expressed concerns about the role of private equity.
Sorry, Jim, I should add one caveat.
Sure.
Sorry to interrupt you, Jim, and I think we're on a bit of a delay. One thing I'd add, I think I said something broad, like it isn't the private equity that in and of itself condemns a transaction, right? If you had a private equity company and they're sitting running two competitors and there are only two competitors in the market, yes, there are issues that may arise. But standing alone, the fact of private equity's involvement, in my mind, doesn't condemn a thing.
Well, Commissioner Chopra has expressed his views that private equity firms do not necessarily have the same incentives to compete as other privately or publicly held companies. What do you see as the role of private equity firms in the healthcare industry?
I'll begin by saying I'm not sure I understand that criticism of private equity firms. It's not clear to me at all why they have less of an incentive to compete. They have similar incentives to make money as public firms. I think in certain quarters, there is a general dislike for private equity. Some of that might be competition related. I suspect a lot of it is distribution related. You know, we've had concerns about loading companies up with debt and then shutting things down about private equity since the 70s, right, and the sort of leveraged buyout craze, if not earlier than that. I don't think that's new. I don't know that it's always a competition problem. One of the things, and you see this in the DOJ's remedy publication recently, if private equity is providing capital in a new space, that can be a good thing. It can be pro-competitive to have that kind of financial backing. Different private equity companies have different profiles in how they conduct their businesses. And even within one private equity firm, they may have different strategies for how they'll deal with different portfolio companies. I don't think that private equity in and of itself, it draws attention for a lot of reasons, but it's not clear to me at all that it is a competitive problem. I'd add the following. I think in general, over time, you see kind of a downward trend in the interests of firms to go public, right, through the public markets. Private equity is filling some of that space. There are big debates about whether that's good or bad. And, you know, I think we've all watched with interest flourishing SPACs, right, which are a different way to go public. That's something we're seeing a lot of in the market. Those are fine debates, but I don't know that private equity ought to put you in the penalty box ab initio. In fact, I don't believe that.
Since we're getting late in the hour, Mike, I'm going to move on to you for an additional question.
Let me mention that if any of the listeners have questions, we will review the chat feature. So you can send us questions that way. We just budgeted another 8 minutes or so. I should have mentioned that earlier. Just to stay on this idea of roll-up or non-reportable transactions, I wanted to link it, Commissioner Phillips, to something important you said on state AGs. And I think what you've said is a little, I think is important, and you say it differently than other leaders at DOJ and FTC in my experience. I understood you to say it's in everyone's interest to try to be complement what the agencies do or the federal and state officials do. And I, you know, my own experience, I've been on some very national and global matters where you have, you know, a very substantial, capable FTC or Justice Department team, and then you have a coalition of a dozen, could be two dozen state AGs, and, you know, they're dialing into calls. And sometimes we feel, I know the states add a lot of value, but sometimes we feel it's kind of piling on and duplicative. I hear you saying, you know, a key objective is to work to find, you know, complementary areas for enforcement. There are lots of complaints, credible complaints, in my view, in healthcare about non-reportable deals. You hear complaints about, you know, hospital systems doing baby step transactions, and, you know, payers wake up one day and there's this, you know, big system, yet you never really had a single transaction that was reportable. Is this an area where you think state AG should be more active? It's an area where they have, relatively stronger expertise compared to, you know, some, you know, global deal?
I think it's probably the area that I would tout where this complementarity of function, us working with, alongside, right, or parallel to state AG efforts can be really helpful. I am concerned, right, whether it's part of a roll-up or just a standalone transaction, that doesn't matter. But I am concerned that there are smaller deals, in particular in, let's say, rural communities or other communities where you don't have good substitutability in the services that a hospital or a doctor group, let's say, is providing. I am concerned that there are deals that we are missing and not challenging. And litigation is expensive and resources are limited. Those are real issues. Concentration in these markets, by the way, labor too, right? The labor for nurses and specialized doctors, where barriers to entry exist. I think the best strategy moving forward for enforcers, and this may not be for clients, but for enforcers, is to try to divide the world and say, hey, look, we can't go after this. Maybe you should. Many people believe that there is more anti-competitive M&A conduct going on than agencies are able to address, whether they're federal or state. If you believe that, then I think it is a better play for everyone to sort of collectively cover the field. So to me, this is really one of the best areas, you know, again, specifically hospitals, doctor groups, healthcare generally, where we can work together with state AGs, have a real impact that benefits consumers, keeping the price of healthcare lower, right? The price of healthcare, if you ask most Americans, is like at the height of their concern. And I think we have an important role to play there. And I want to work with state AGs to effectuate that.
You mentioned impact on workers and healthcare. I think there's a point of view that one of the innovations in this administration has to bring antitrust to focus more on workers. And there have been, over the years, there have been some cases where, you know, hospitals were sharing too much information in a way that could suppress wages for nurses or could suppress wages for other healthcare professionals. Is it fair to say that that is becoming an area of more attention and standardized analysis?
Yeah, right. And we're going to be interested in knowing about what the non-compete arrangements are, right? Because there can be a real benefit to consumers for having workers be able to move, right, and compete out their skills. That also helps the workers, but I think it also can help consumers a lot.
Well, we've been fortunate to have an hour of your time, Commissioner Phillips. Why don't the three of us just quickly check the chat room, and otherwise we'll adjourn. Let's just take a minute.
Or if anyone has a question, now is a good time to send us one.
It looks like we've got a bunch in the chat room. I'll let you guys pick which ones to ask, but I'm happy to take a few questions. Mike, Jim, that's me waiting for you to ask. I'll let you pick which ones you find most appealing.
Jim, do you want to proceed?
Yeah, we have a question that someone sent us about whether the FTC is thinking about changing its strategy to tackle COPAs that states are turning to. Do you have any comments on that?
We do a fair amount of our best work, I think, in advocacy to state legislatures and state authorities around COPAs. You know, there are a lot of indications that suggest that their effects are not good for consumers, that they limit competition. I hope that advocacy work continues, is the short answer to that question. We probably haven't done enough messaging to answer the specifics. Are we considering changing that strategy?
Jim, are there any others you want to raise?
I think we have room probably for one more.
My apologies.
With the impending, we have a question about the impending election, and how do you view M&A activity and the FTC's involvement related to that?
So, you know, taking in particular the public statements and the dissents, in particular the dissents of my colleagues on a number of high-profile M&A cases, as some sort of barometer for, you know, if the Democrats won the election, how would things look? I don't know that that necessarily is a barometer, and I certainly don't know who's going to win the election. They routinely suggest that enforcement is insufficient. They want to see us making bright line competition rules. They want to see us pursuing theories on, I think, less evidence than I would think warrants a theory. There's been back and forth in many cases about that. So my sense is that you will see more activity in a variety of different ways with respect to M&A.
And we're by more we're slightly activity, over.
You know, I do imagine a lot of this may be more litigation. Sorry.
Why do you foresee more litigation, Commissioner Phillips?
Well, if you take the concern that I raised in Bristol-Myers Celgene, that to some extent what the dissents reflected were just sort of a generalized opposition to M&A, there may be times where maybe fewer times where the agencies and parties cannot meet minds on what a settlement would look like. On some level, a settlement needs the support of a majority of the commission. And if, again, this depends on a lot of things that we don't know, like what will the deals look like and what position will people take and who wins the election? And if we have a new commissioner, who's that commissioner, right? There's a lot of unknowns here. But I do think they've certainly, you know, Bristol Myers is a good example. I sort of said, like, you really want to sue here? Is that what you want? But that seemed to be precisely what was desired. And, you know, that may be the result.
Disagreement on settlements means more likelihood of litigation, right?
I think so. I mean, it may be scuttled deals. There may be some, you know, strategic behavior. You threaten to go to court, and then, you know, some often parties don't want to deal with the hassle of litigation. It isn't worth it. And there may be some of that, but I do think all things equal, litigation is something that my colleagues have called for more, and I have no reason to believe if our switches that isn't what we see.
Well, Commissioner Phillips, we want to be respectful of your time, and we, you know, are fortunate to have this time with you. Thank you so much for your for the conversation and for your insights, and we appreciate the listeners' patience and participation. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Sure. Well, thanks for having me. I hope the next time we do that, it's in person.
Same here. Good afternoon.